It's a gold.
In the worlds before monkey, primal chaos reigned.
It's a beautiful, what is it, Wednesday? A Wednesday night here on the beautiful Gold Coast in Burleigh Heads. Ow! Ow! This podcast is brought to you by Koala Karma, the chill out drink. Sit back, relax, and damn, look who we've got in the studio tonight. I cannot believe this great story and that we've actually put it together. All the way from, well, Brisbane today, but previously from Melbourne. Douzey, come on! Yay. Let's hear it. The winner of our battle of the bands that we pretty much just made up on the fly, and we couldn't believe you even entered. And
I just did it like really late at night as well.
How did you find it?
On like a Facebook page, you posted on it, and it was like the last day or something, and someone posted it, and I was like, oh, magic. Here it goes, because it was the demo as well. It wasn't the official.
Well, we by the way, in the room we have MATTG Photography. We also have Greasy Belcher.
Howdy.
Our champion as co-host tonight. Aaron Brunner from Aaron Brunner Media.
Evening.
How are you, buddy?
There you go.
Hey, we got something to talk about tonight, you and me, champ. And on the couch, as usual, our number one audience member, Craig Curtis. Revive car detailing. This week's special on polishing. I don't know. That's a beautiful time. Honestly, okay, think about it. Think about my life, right, Douzey, for a minute. We've got this show. We've got all these great friends that come in on this. And it just came about, a battle of the bands, you know, because I've been in so many bands. And it's really a concept I sort of stole from another podcast show I listen to. They do it a bit different. But I loved hearing them talk live about bands they didn't know about and what they thought of it. And I thought, oh, man, every band I've been in, Carlos, you're in a... Greasy, you're in a...
Stone Rising.
In a band Stone Rising, right?
Hell yeah! We're gonna have a good time. We come on rocking it out, we feel fine. Keep your motor on the red line, my God, this weekend.
And if you could only play your music to someone and hear what they're honestly thinking about it on the fly and even looking
just
up your
just
pictures.
Just the music, no images.
No, but then forcing everyone to look at the image and see, oh, wow, that the person looks like that. You had purple hair. It was like a super bonus because I thought your song was dark and, you know, if you looked like Jan Brady, I'd be really like, oh, by the way, how old are you?
22.
Man, you're going to hear some references tonight to stuff you have no idea about, like Jan Brady. Do you know what the Brady Bunch is?
Yeah.
Do you really?
Yes, of course I do. Man.
You know what I heard today? Can I tell you something? Today, Aaron, you were there. What's that song? Well, you done leaving your bed, I felt it. They tried to meet you to just so hard that I felt it. You know that song?
Yeah.
Well, that's 10 years old today.
Whoa.
That's how old I am. To me, that's like the other day.
So
how long ago was Metallica?
Who's Metallica?
Yeah, of course you were. You were in primary school.
Oh, my goodness.
You weren't even born, probably. I don't know. Did you say your age? Or is that rude to say?
No, I'm 22. That's fine.
Far out. What does that mean? You're born in 1998. I had a 95. Beard, 12 kids. Okay.
You had a beard.
95.
Actually, I won the Queensland Rock Awards in 1994.
Oh, there you go.
What?
Yeah.
We should be interviewing you.
No. It's a dud story. Leads to here, which is good. No, seriously, what I mean to say is that I can't believe we created, and all the people in this room, we all voted on these bands. It was 10, really, in the end, because there's a couple that we didn't, like Greasy
had a song. I dropped out when I heard the competition.
You know, but since then, a lot of bands have gone, oh, that was cool, you're going to do another one?
Yeah.
And we were thinking we should do another one in 6 months, so there's like we don't need to wait for a year, it's our own show, you know.
Yeah, that's good. No, it's great. It's a good opportunity, and like I was saying earlier, I just saw it last minute, it was like 11 o'clock at night, and I just sent it through and then didn't think much of it because I always am sending demos and trying to get gigs and everything. So the fact that this one, yeah, made it, I was like, oh, my goodness. And then to even win, I just didn't imagine that would happen.
That's a good attitude, though, because I was surprised how few entries there were. There was only like 10 or 12 entries. When I came back from being overseas, and I said, how many did you get in the end? He said, only 12. I thought, what? But that sums up the attitude of a lot of people in bands.
Yes. I got 16 people said, I'll send you a song.
And nothing happened.
No. Yeah.
But they just whinge about, oh, this is a shit industry. And it's like, well, you're not actually doing anything, so you've won. You're taking pot shots all the time and sending out stuff and just saying, I'm here.
All talk. I left my band because they were all talk.
You hear that, band?
Yeah, bands.
Look what you missed out on.
No, I still love them to bits. I'm still friends with them all, but...
Oh, she likes you a bit. Whatever. No, that was half the fun because... Greasy here, he's a creator. Mm. You know, in my band, I've got a cover band, right? So I own the things like the website. I pay that $300 every year. They book all the gigs, pay everyone. Today I invoice Treasury Casino. Mm. That shit takes time. I'm at a normal job. I go, damn, I've got to invoice something. So it's amazing how you can think the rest of the band do nothing. If only we were firing on all cylinders and working together.
Absolutely. Yeah, that's absolutely what happens with some bands. Some people are just like, oh, we've done it. And then
it's
like, no, I'm not.
Steve. It's Steve, isn't it?
But I think a lot of people can relate to that. I just, have this drive that some people don't have, I guess.
It's good. And how about that? This is what happened today, all right? We're drinking here, as. Lost Palms beer, okay? Give us a carton of beer a week. How good is that? Lost Palms all the way from Miami.
That lasts a day, by the way.
I said in Gold Coast. When I first read Miami, I was like, what, America?
No. Oh, yeah, you got to get up on all our daggy names. Miami, Florida Keys. There's a whole bunch of those ones. Anyway, so John. I said, John, mate, can you drop them off today? Because we've got a podcast with Douzey tonight, who won our comp, and turns out she's all the way from Melbourne. She's only been in Brisbane for a month, and she's coming on. He goes, oh, great, maybe she could do a gig at our brewery. Yeah. Our great, you should see this place. It's as pretty as these cans. It's really
it is,
well.
I quite like the cans. They're quite pretty.
Yeah, so they've got this great venue, food, drinks, and they've invited Douzey to play there, and she's going to play there on Saturday this coming.
Yeah, Saturday afternoon, 3 to 5.
But you said something that you said something. Oh, that sounds great. I just got to find out if I can do it, and you know, someone can fill in for me at work up there in Brisbane. And it reminded me of something that, like, I did way back in when I was your age. Mm. There's a couple of great things that I won't even bring them up. It's like name dropping, but a couple of great key things that happened that I went, oh no, I can't do that because I'm a courier driver. Right, I just got this job and I've only been there for 2 weeks, and they'll be so annoyed, right? Mm. And then Eminem 5 years later came out with a song. You better lose yourself in the music the moment you own it. You better never let it go. Ho, only get one shot. Do not miss your chance to blow. This opportunity comes once in a lifetime, and it's so true. In the game you're in, like music and opportunity and fashion and that sort of shit. It only happens once.
Yeah.
Like, it really does. So you took that gig?
Yes, I did, because it was during the day.
You so get that, Steve?
Yeah.
See what's happening now?
Steve. Steve.
But now I've got to try and find a lift to drive all my gear down.
Do you? That's Aaron.
Yeah. Fancy road trip?
Yeah. All of these guys.
But it should be fun. I'm excited.
Yeah. Well, how cool is that?
Yeah.
Where's the brewery, Drew? Just while we're on air.
Yeah.
Mate, the greatest brewery in the world. It's just behind the KFC at Miami, right?
Okay.
So you've got the beach only 100 metres away. Right there behind is this, where Miami Marquetta is. It's probably 20 metres from there.
Cool.
Yeah. Oh, man, you'll love it. It's a really nice place.
We'll do it.
Yeah. There's, bikies there. No, there's not.
People eating chickens.
Yeah, you don't know what you're walking into, but it's lucky you. It's a really great place, you know.
You might get to play Miami Marquetta after that.
Yeah. Well, yeah. 100% you will.
You never know.
You got purple hair. You got
purple hair. Move to the coast.
Yes.
Yeah. Yeah, well, here's the thing, right? See, we call this Australia's hardest working podcast show, right? Because every single person in this room works hard outside of this podcast show. Just putting this on, I think, is really special. So for you to actually put your song in and, well, John from the brewery, who's also working ridiculous hours, he liked the idea and we're all attracted to those people.
Yeah, absolutely. People that are, like, out going, doing things.
We need doers in our movement is absolutely. What we're saying here.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So tell us a bit about it yourself. Are you on the run? Why are you in Brisbane? No?
I have family up here. And I'm running away from winter. It's like -4 degrees in Melbourne. So it's so nice. I'm like walking around here and I'll be out with friends and they're like, it's freezing. And I'm like, nah, singlet and shorts and I'm fine.
Yeah.
But yeah.
Have you had summer here yet?
No. Well, I've come up a few times to visit family and such. So I had family here. And then I came up, actually, we drove past a cheer gym that I did cheerleading at when I came up here. Zach's Zoo Athletics Cheer, which is around the corner, and I recognised it. I was like, I was here last year. So I came up in October.
Did they kick your butts, probably? Yeah.
No, we won.
Come on. Was that you standing on somebody's hand on Instagram?
Yeah. So I do cheerleading. What's going on here? So my team came up to compete, and we won. Yeah, and I visited family while I was up here, and then me and my cousin went out, and she was like, you should move up here. And I was like, yeah, that'd be fun. And then, 6 months later, I was like, all right, I'm coming out, Georgia.
Greasy, he was in Sweden Rock Festival only 2 weeks ago, right?
Yeah.
And we were talking about this on the last episode. When my band moved to Sydney, right, we were the band from Brisbane, which didn't mean much, I'll be honest, in Sydney, but when you were in Sydney, the band from Melbourne was coming up, you know, and everyone would go, ooh, let's go see that, you know. You'd like, so you'll be the girl from Melbourne.
Yeah, I actually, it's great. Purple Hair's a really great conversation starter. And the first few days I was in Brisbane, this guy came up to me and he's like, I really appreciate your hair. And I was like, thanks. And then I asked where something was. We ended up talking and he found out I was creative. He's like, I'm going to this open mic next week with some friends. You're welcome to join. And then, so then I got there and I was like, you know what? I'm just going to get up and then I sang and then said, hey, I'm from Melbourne. I don't know anyone. And everyone came up to me and started talking to me. And now one of the girls is my drummer for my gig tomorrow.
Unreal.
So, like, I just was like, hey, I don't know anyone. And just by saying that, like, Brisbane people are so nice and so lovely. And they just came up to me and wanted to talk to me.
Unreal.
And I was like, yay, I finally have friends.
I saw her on Instagram then. That's... You're in someone's, your bedroom or something?
Yeah, so Lauren's tiny little apartment. She's got it, like, because she invited me over to her house for a party because she's an artist. And she's like, do you want to come over and paint? And I was like, that sounds amazing. And we went and painted. And then I walked into her room and saw she was a drummer. I was like, and she was like, and then,
can she play the drums?
Really?
Yeah. Oh, she's great. And we're getting all these percussion instruments and everything for the gig tomorrow. It's really exciting.
Unreal.
Nice.
Greasy, he's from Ireland, right?
The universe, just...
And the accent and the things like the hair, like when, you know, Greasy, you're from Ireland.
Yeah.
Yeah, so that, I don't care who you are, you're like, oh, he sounds interesting, what's, you know, it opens doors, I'm sure. Like
it literally does. When I used to knock doors and sell stuff door to door for a living when I came to the coast, I used to get into more houses than anybody else in the company, just for having an Irish accent, it was weird, you know? And there was two Irish guys in the boss that say, I'm hiring more Irish guys. Because you just knock on doors and people go, oh, come on in.
Yeah, absolutely.
You know, I am going to try and sell you stuff. Like, oh, come on in.
Do you want a pint?
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, that was the case most of the time.
Well, when I go to Japan, they're all just like beer and steak. So, for some reason, like Aussies over there, everyone says, you want meat? It's like, oh, no, why? Because McDonald's always say, Aussie beef. McDonald's all has Aussie beef.
Tokyo beef. They entered the
show. They entered this comp too. Yeah. Right, so how did you create that kind of song? This is me asking because I've played guitar pretty much my whole life and it's got this cool, it's like a poker feel, yeah? How did you create this song? It's so layered, that's what I mean.
I I'm trying to think the first time I started writing this song, because I wrote it over a year ago. It's taken a while to get it together. And I started with the plucking thing, and then I had the line, "She fell from new heights in the heat of February." I had that line because I write notes on my phone. I carry notebooks everywhere and I write things down, and then when something comes, it comes. And I had just been studying Shakespeare, and I wrote an essay. I think I wrote an essay on it, and then I had to do a creative thing as well. But I had just finished reading Hamlet, and I really loved the floral verse that she says. So a lot of that chorus is directly from Hamlet. So people who are fans of Shakespeare will totally listen to this and hopefully really admire
it. Which lines? So Ophelia is the character in Hamlet.
Ophelia is the female character.
I was going to say that last week. Yeah.
It's not the Cheech and Chong thing?
No.
Ophelia Bonnie Belly. I keep going.
No, so I wanted to write about Ophelia from her perspective, because Hamlet treats her like absolute crap in the production, and she is perceived as this crazy woman. Helena Bonham Carter does an amazing portrayal of her, of this crazy thing. So if you want to see that, I don't know who's the director of the version that she's in, but she's for
Is it called Hamlet?
It is Hamlet.
Is it?
I don't know. I'm just thinking because I've watched.
She's normally in all the.
Tim Burton. Yeah, but she's really young in her family. Okay. This is when she was starting her career. But
she's
so brilliant.
Yeah, but she's actually, if I was to put an actress beside Ophelia the song, she'd be that. You know
yeah,
what I'm saying?
Absolutely.
If we were characterizing you before we even saw what you looked like, Helen Bonham Carter could actually write and sing this song.
Well, maybe we can make we'll make it happen, you know?
yeah. She'd be creepy in real life, I reckon.
Me too. I'd love to meet her. She's amazing. She's a big inspiration. So I was studying Hamlet and I've watched that, and that's where I got kind of the verses from, and then just the butters kind of came to me, and then I was jamming out the song, and it slowly added electronic elements, and there's a didgeridoo sound in there because I was like, I love didgeridoos. I don't know. I remember being three and I think three or four and seeing a didgeridoo for the first time, and ever since then I've always absolutely loved them. And so I wanted a little didgeridoo sound, and I wanted all these little electronic elements, and then just put it together, and finally it's finished. It's so lovely to finally have something completed.
How long did it take to record that track?
So it was done in two parts. So all the guitars and everything was done, and then the vocals were recorded probably over an hour in the studio, and then my producer, Josh Ladgrove, who he just brought it up to a whole new level, and he's added a bass and some other stuff into it as well. So, actually recording is probably about 5 hours worth, but it's scattered over a year.
Yeah, just keeps till you know.
Till you know, yeah. Because I remember I finished it a while back, and I thought I had finished it, and everyone was like, "It's done." But there was a part of me that didn't think it was done. And then I was friends with Josh because I worked at Comedy Festival, and he is a comedian. And we were talking, and he was like, "I'd love to check it out." And I gave him all the stems, and he just completely changed it. I was like, "Oh my gosh, you need to get on this track." And he's actually doing all the producing for my whole EP.
He's still in Melbourne?
Yes, he's Melbourne based.
Okay.
But he floats between Sydney and Melbourne.
Cool.
But yeah.
What's his name?
So his name's Josh Ladgrove. And then my sound engineer is Neil Lawrence. So
wow.
Yeah, and Neil Lawrence is my mentor, and he's kind of helped me realize.
Here's the thing,
Douzey.
Right? So when you came first into the studio this afternoon, you were up here sound checking because you're going to sing the song a little bit later, yes, right? When you get to the ba 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 na, I'm like, yeah, it's got that bit in it. It's a cool song because we listen to so many songs, and I've been in so many bands. It's the great songs have those little changes where you go, oh, yeah, this song's still got that bit in it yet. Not just a verse, chorus, bridge, verse, oh, you know, verse, chorus, bridge, verse, chorus, which is a classic AC/DC song, which I still love. But your song feels like it's got four or five little bits in it. Oh. Because you go, oh, yeah, it's got the ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-na. You know, that's what makes a great song compared to some of the others we kind of heard. With it. It's just straight rock and roll, but it makes them kind of look a bit silly. when you battle of the banding.
Steve.
Yeah, Steve.
Techniques and
still
vibes.
Out there doing AC/DC.
Steve. Can I tell you something? Aaron Brunner, right, and I, last night, who else was there? Greasy, you were there.
Where?
At Adam Brand, he's a big country...
At the AC/DC concert.
Oh, mate.
At the Drew's unveiling.
Last night, I was in the... I hope... It was good fun. We made a video clip. There's a country singer called Adam Brand.
Yeah.
Right, and he won Dancing with the... With the Stars. I've won... He's like this media darling, as they say, right? Great dude. I've known him for 20 years. And so he's got this record out, Adam Brand Milestones. He's won like 13 Tamworth Golden Guitars. And he's right with Keith Urban. There's Adam Brand, that sort of dude, right?
Keith Urban without Big Nicole. Name. Same level.
Is that what you texted me about initially?
Yeah.
And I knew nothing about it. I was like, what?
Yeah, no,
and I freaked out because I thought, I was like, oh, I thought it was Wednesday. And I was in Redcliffe and I was like, oh, no.
Well, it's almost, I went, oh, who do I know? There's Ryan Murr from Former Angels. He'd love to be there, you know. Colt Seavers, he was just here. Dean Caulfield, you know. I got music heads. It was Cindy from Buskers by the Creek. By the way, you're on her stage. Buskers by the Creek, greatest festival in the world. Two-day festival.
When is
She's
it?
She's already invited
Next
you.
Next weekend.
Playing.
This
yeah, October,
weekend.
13th and 14th.
Oh,
year.
October.
No.
Oh, awesome.
Yeah.
Yeah.
How about that? Ta-da.
That's so exciting. Thank you.
It's a big thing on the Southern Gold Coast. It takes half the Southern Gold Coast to hear.
So it's on the big screen now.
Oh, my God. Oh, wow. Look at this. Who got footage of this?
Is this what you filmed yesterday?
So basically the song is, right, look at me. I've put on 7 kilos lately. Look at this fat guy. But I love it. And it plays a perfect character in this, right? I'm the Aussie guy. He's the American guy. So what I'm describing to anyone listening to the audio only is the Adam Brand video. It's this great song that isn't released yet that I actually think is going to be a belter, a banger. This is how the chorus goes. One of the choruses.
Are you going to sing it for us?
Wolverine, akadaka, crocodile hunter. Woo, 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 party down under. Beer bombs in his honor. So it's, look. So I'm the Aussie dude. The vibe of the clip was that there's the, like, Americans, you have the UFC, but we have, like, punching on in the backyard. Americans, you have gridiron. We have like, oh shit! Look at you go, Aaron. So it's in our headsets right now.
He knows what he's doing.
Anyway, so this was last night. So they kept giving me these rum cans, and it got really loose.
Oh, nice!
But what
did you get to keep drinking though? Like, oh no, I've read.
So there's Adam Brand there. Have you ever seen his face before? Just say yes.
I can't see that far.
No?
I don't have my glasses on.
Oh, that's a yes then. Hang on. Well, that's the first.
Ooh, so like.
I know. Well, you think of country music.
Reminds me of Footloose.
Country music, by the way, is massive. We don't know it. People outside.
Oh,
country.
Yeah. There's a whole country music channel.
Oh, yeah.
Well, maybe we need to. I need to write a song with him now.
Oh, yeah. Get to the chorus. Yeah. Look how fat I am. Can you not pause on that bit, though? Jesus Christ. Look at the. See, when I get fat, it's all about these. And my chin, right there. I went running this morning.
This isn't the video, by the way.
It's not very energetic, is
Thanks,
it?
Thanks,
Sam. No, it looks great.
Anyway.
It sounds like it was a lot of fun. I wish that.
He's got a huge crowd. I'm talking 20 years of making records, like real records, when records were records. Right, so he has so many.
From Gold Coast?
He's actually from Perth, but he lives on the Gold Coast right now.
Oh, awesome. Maybe we need to link up and write a song.
I hope you do. Wouldn't that be
really
amazing?
Cool. I mean, I've never written country, but I was a big T-Swift fan growing up.
My dog and my truck.
I don't know if you can call her country anymore, though. But
who?
Taylor Swift.
Oh, yeah, I know.
I was a big T-Swift fan.
Yeah.
Still am, let's be honest.
Okay, imagine, well, this could be your projection anyway, Douzey. Here you are, you're playing. I always think, wow, Taylor Swift and even Beyonce, like these big stars, yeah. They actually write these songs either on piano. They're sitting in their room. Oh, I know, Christina. Let's talk about the girls, right? So these big stars, we only see the pop version with these mass-produced songs.
Absolutely.
But they pretty much always come from a guitar somewhere in someone's bedroom.
Absolutely.
Sure, they buy the song now probably, you know. When you get that popularity, you sort of can choose from writers, but you know, a big classic.
Yeah, there was my favorite little story I heard is Kimbra on Gotcha, somebody I used to know recorded that in her like bedroom, and it was supposed to be just the demo. And then they were like, yeah, we want it. And then she's like, cool, I'll go to the studio and record it. They were like, no, we're just going to use this one. She's like, free, apparently, was like, like, didn't think it was that good.
How's that go again? See that.
But you didn't have to call me up.
It's great
video. We were nothing at all.
It's a very, very original video as well.
Who is it?
Gotye.
Now we're just somebody that didn't use.
Is that Kimbra's song?
No, Kimbra is on it as well.
Yeah. Oh, man, she's so hot.
She's
got a fringe. Oh.
Yeah, she's really cool.
Those fringes, those rock and roll fringes.
Mm.
If you want to look up my most ultimate girl in the world, which I know you do. I know
everyone's on the keyboards right now.
Look up that song. They performed that song. Gotye and Kimbra performed that song on American, I think it's like Letterman, right?
Yeah.
You just heard me burp then in the mic a bit. Welcome to my show.
You're supposed to blame me.
That happens all the time. Thank you to Lost Palms. Oh, my God. She comes out in that middle. How does a bit go where she sings? Do you remember?
Oh, I don't know the lyrics off the top of my head. Damn it, I should have.
Aaron's going to flash them up on screen.
That's what I mean. That song have been so popular without the fashionable cool of Kimbra. You know, they're working together. And when it comes to video and video clips and...
Yeah, the clip is cool. The guy's just getting painted over on the wall.
Yeah, that's really cool.
Really unique. Damn, you know, it's like,
look it up right
it's like a Peter Gabriel clip from years ago when he did Sledgehammer, and it was just a new thing that really kind of changed the direction for a lot of people.
Where the hell has he gone since?
He made all this money, and you know, he's just doing whatever he wants.
Yeah.
He would have made money in the...
He was from my area in Melbourne.
Really?
Yeah, they talk about it a lot. They're like, he went to... Right. He was Genesis. College.
Well, he lived in Sydney when I left Sydney. I remember he was doing gigs in Sydney when we were...
Gabriel?
No.
I was going to say...
you still talking about me? Sorry. It's weird when you sit over there, isn't it?
Yeah, who are you talking about?
Gotye.
Oh, okay.
Which I always thought was Goiter. I'm like, oh, that's a bit weird.
Goiter.
I'm curious to know where that name...
Oh, I'm good, thank you.
...came from.
Yeah. No, I did hear him say that. Anyway, hey... Doozy's here. This is great news. Now, can I tell you something? Let's talk about the prizes you have won.
I know, I'm very...
Yeah?
I'm particularly interested in this axe throwing thing. Like, I've already messaged my friend. I was like, BYO beards. Like, can we full-on dress up?
They even have beards there for you.
Oh, really? Okay, because I was, like, on eBay. And, of course, when I look up lumberjack woman, it just comes up with the sluttiest outfits. And I was like, no, I just want to wear plaid and flannies.
Yeah, well, we had these guys in the... They actually, if you want to do something really cool, is go to Dracula's on the Gold Coast. You've got one in Melbourne.
Yeah,
it's the same family.
Melbourne.
Well, it's the same...
Oh,
it started here on the Gold Coast and went to Melbourne, so they're the same company.
It's a lot of fun.
Cool.
Well, these guys worked at Dracula's for a long time. So we got their whole story on this show, actually. It was really cool. These guys that worked in hospitality, and they went to Hard Rock Cafe, and they just kept working together in funny ways, like doing all the late shift, clocking off at like midnight, and just went, what are we going to do? They thought they could sell like outdoor furniture for a bit. You know, these are just good guys, good mates. And then someone who was making Lumberpunks overseas, or like an axe throwing place, and with, what's that TV show? Thrones. Apparently there's a bit of Thrones.
Game of Thrones?
Yeah, I don't watch it either.
Oh, Game of Thrones?
Yeah, do you watch it?
Yes, of course.
Oh, I haven't seen it. Anyway.
I've started reading the
Viking culture.
Yeah.
Yeah? They created the greatest thing. And I'm stoked that you're going to go there.
I'm pretty excited.
Because they took us there. They took Matt G and I and Ricka. Where are you, Ricka? And it's crazy good.
Yeah, it sounds like a lot of fun. I'm excited.
Yeah. $500 cash.
Yeah.
I'm going to have to go to the ATM straight after this. I actually forgot you. Yeah. This is worth $1 million because if you haven't looked up Matt G's Instagram and website and Gold Coast Photography Studio, GC Photo,
yeah,
he's the killer.
Yeah, like, they're amazing.
Band photography, low light studio photography, and the greatest
What's
stuff.
The website? So, GC?
And that's big money. If you're ever in a band, you try and get everyone tries to get their friends to do it, and it always looks like dog shit.
So that's GC Photography. .com.
GC Photo, I think it's the...
GCphoto.com.au. Yeah. Cool.
That's stoked, man. Yeah, that's really generous.
I'm super excited.
And then we've got a video clip.
Yeah, I'm going to help you make a cool video, hopefully.
From Greasy Belcher.
Nice.
Yeah. And, okay, let's talk about this. Oh, by the way, and also Matt Bowland. Matt Bowland's in a great Tenpin Bowland, right? Brisbane had this great rock and roll band called Rollerball.
Mm.
And right now they've got it's a tribute band, but they're singing Soundgarden, Pearl Jam, maybe Nirvana. It's like a 90s tribute show. But have you ever tried to sing a Soundgarden song?
I don't know.
It's very hard. Like, I'm talking, this dude is a singer. And he sat in this podcast studio and said he'd if you wanted to.
No, absolutely. Like, I still get vocal coaching when I want to cover certain songs to help with, like, because you're always learning and, you know, your voice is a muscle. Like, when you go to the gym, you want to have a coach. So I absolutely, like, that would be amazing.
And I think it's good for this. He's, when I did my first guitar gig, I was like, I didn't even know where to put my amp. Like, you stumble through some shit for like 6 gigs.
Yeah,
you can have a coach going, no, did you know it's cool to bring your own mic? Like, the sound guy loves that if you do that. There's a cool certain things that, which I think a vocal coach will do.
Yeah, and yeah, definitely. I use a loop pedal, and you learn pretty fast that you can't have it. Like, the microphone has to be away, otherwise you're going to be re-looping things and everything.
Really, I know
like
nothing
that.
About those things. You know.
Oh, they're so much fun. It takes a while. It takes a lot of practice. I had a lot of fun just sitting there and
What kind of loop pedal is it?
A GC300 Boss.
Okay, so it's a pretty decent one.
Yeah, just like I wanted just like the two pedals, nothing too big. Because I was looking at the big ones, but I was like, you know what? Just start basic.
I picked up a looper pedal recently. They're a lot of fun because you can, if you just come up with something nice, you just step on it and then step on it
again. Yeah,
it's
really good for riding. It's really good for riding songs. And I cover a lot of my own friends' songs practicing on there.
Right.
Yeah.
Actually,
do you use any other pedals when you perform live?
No, I don't.
Okay.
But I do have a guitarist coming for my gig tomorrow, and he's got a few effects and stuff.
Nice.
See, it would be a weird world for me to see the kids doing original gigs right now because, you know, back in my day, it was like straight ahead rock and roll pretty much everywhere you went. If someone had a keyboard, that was like something. Looper pedals, that means the bass player may have a loop pedal. Kids are playing. Listen to me. You know you're old when you say the kids, but I fuck yous all. I am saying it, right? I've been drinking beetroot beer. No, seriously, like, what are they doing right now? Greasy, you'd know. You're out there.
Yeah, yeah. Have you seen Wayward Sons? They won the Early Beach Band Contest a few months ago, but they've got like DJ. They got two kind of Kiwi. Well, one of them's a Kiwi. I don't know where the other guy's from. But
oh, dude, they're I've partied with them. They were in that penthouse that night. I forgot it was them. they've got a rapper guy.
Yeah, they got a rapper. They got a cool bass player playing a massive guy playing bass, and then they've got a DJ kind of set up. They're playing iPads and everything, but they got the full band instruments, but they're backing it up with loops.
Yeah,
and
it's
things
all programmed
like that.
In. All right, because that's what I do. I have a few because I work a lot with like R&B hip hop music. Like, I kind of got into that crowd in Melbourne, and sampling stuff. So you want to repeat it, so then you can add more or less, or sing over, or stop a section, or play guitar over it and stuff like that. So it's really good for just jamming out and making a fuller sound than just. ding-a-ding with your guitar.
Do the kids still... Come on, tell
the
me.
Kids.
Do the kids still love a good... Like
a good live drum kit.
Yeah,
live drum is one thing I will always want on my stage. Yeah. It makes such a difference having live drums than having...
It's something about movement that I love to see because look at that shiny kit. Just, like, things are gleaming off. And then every now and then you get someone who is just the ultimate rock and roller on a drum kit.
Absolutely.
And they could be playing to anyone. And it just sells, like, you sort of go, yeah, I'm a part of some sort of scene, some sort of group here.
Yeah.
And Come on, Douzey.
It does change the sound because originally when I was recording a bunch of my songs, I was just going to go electronic, and then a girl I worked with, Baby G is her name.
Baby G.
She's DJ and drummer. I found out she was a drummer and I was like, do you want to play drums on my track? And she was like, yeah, girl, let's do this. And it took all my songs to the next level, having her play on them.
Okay. Hang on a minute. Does Ophelia have drums on it?
Yeah. On that song, it's electric drums, though. It's very soft.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, there's one cool thing about having an electric drum kit. Have you, I don't know if you've ever gone into a studio with a drummer, bass player for the first time. The drummer is his own, their own people. They want the drums loud.
Yeah.
Like, but if you listen to a great Beatles song or any sort of great song, you'll notice that often the drums are as low as... It's just this little... Because there's, But it's really hard to get your drummer mate to understand that every time. They're like, no, I want to do the backups. Oh.
All the
do you just want a good song or do you just want a... It's really hard when you're in a big band.
That's part of working in a team.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's good.
Do you have any hobbies?
Hobbies.
You don't answer that. I don't know. Can you juggle?
I can juggle 3.
Can you?
Yeah. Oh. Not very well.
I can't. 45 years and I still can't juggle.
I do cheerleading. So I haven't been doing it since being up at Gold Coast. I haven't found a gym yet. And also you kind of have to commit to a team and it's mid-season at the moment, so it's a bit hard. But, yeah, I did that growing up and still
do
that.
Do they have positions in that or is it?
Yeah, so there's a couple of positions, but you can kind of move around. So you have, like, a base and then you have a flyer and then there's a back base. So you can specialise in back basing or side basing. And then, higher up when you're getting 3 people high, there'll be, like, different types of flyers as well.
Flyers are obviously the people flipping.
Yeah, the girls in the air. Or guys, they have.
I actually work with 2 big cheer groups here.
Oh, really?
Yeah, one feeds the Gold Coast Titans rugby league team. That's mega,
awesome.
Mega cheer.
Okay, is that like they're doing flips and stuff like that?
Oh, yeah.
Because the Storm cheerleaders are just dancers generally.
Oh, no. Well, this is just a big place called Mega Cheer.
Okay.
And within that, they have this and this and this and
cool,
jazz and
yeah.
blah, 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 blah. It's like a really big thing.
Yeah. I have
then
a lot of people.
Karumban Cheer is another one down there.
Yeah, I have a lot of people that are like, oh, you must be good at dancing. And I'm like, no. Like, I can be choreographed, but I'm not a very good dancer.
Yeah, of course, because you're doing gymnastics.
Yeah.
What about, can you do the one where you do like a flip, 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 backflip, stand on your feet?
Yes.
Shut up. Can you?
Yes. And there might be something on my Instagram.
That's a coincidence because so can Greasy.
Yeah, only on the stairs, though. A few beers.
Yeah.
And I still didn't spill a drop.
You know what's crazy? It's like cheer and yeah, let's talk to this one for a while. Can I tell you something, guys?
He's going to go, yep.
Is it that one?
Yeah, this one.
No, it's that one. Okay.
All right. Aaron just wants us to look at him. In his way.
Which way?
Aww. Hi, guys.
It's the opposite way to which way you think. I don't know why that is, but if I look there, it's that camera, and I go...
Yeah, you don't worry about it. It's that camera.
I know, but it's weird.
It's the one nearest you. How about that?
It's because the camera's... I mean, the TV's the wrong way for you.
Yeah, it's like the right way for these guys, but for me, it's the other way.
Oh, Jesus Christ. The new Ricker.
Exciting stuff.
Woo! Got one in. Sorry, Ricker. What was I talking about?
Cheerleading.
Oh, yeah. Cheerleading in this day and age, gymnastics, is like being a skateboarder, BMX guy. What the GoPro and what video and YouTube has done to these people, it's made go, oh, I want to do that double backflip. I want to do that. And in 1 week, it's not just like what we all saw. God, I've got to stop relating to old stuff. But before that, you wouldn't even know it, but 4 or 5 TV channels and there was just like one, you'd see the Olympics every 4 years, and that girl could do one.
Yeah.
And wow, I'll never be able to do that until you see that a six-year-old can do it in China on YouTube. It sort of opened up everything. Guitar Absolutely. Solos, learning how to play stuff on drums.
Like, yeah, well, I learned a lot of my guitar stuff from YouTube.
Yeah. Nuts.
Yeah, it's great. And I have filmed stuff with GoPro and it's quite fun. Like it was like a jacket they strapped on.
Oh, yeah.
So we filmed it and so they'd film me doing the skill watching me, but then you actually got my perspective as well. Yeah, which is pretty cool, pretty nifty.
So what's the plan? Are you going to work on an album now? All right.
So I've recorded a few songs. I'm going to release Ophelia officially, hopefully, in the next 2 weeks or so. And then I have another single called Hummus. completely different direction to Ophelia. Then hopefully release the EP towards the end of the year. I don't want to say any dates because I'm terrible at finishing things, but it has to be out this year. That was my goal this year, to get it all out.
We challenge you. Well, I was speaking to Adam Brand, right, last night, because I said, oh, when's this video coming out? He said, oh, it's about 2 weeks. And I went, when's the song coming out? And then I thought, oh, no, when's the record coming out? And then I went, do they make records anymore? Like, what does it mean now? Because, you know, say, here's an interesting one, Kanye West. This story's about 12 months old, so they're probably even doing something completely different.
Yeah.
If you release a song, you're a big name like Kanye. I've got a burp in here somewhere. Right, but you release a song.
So classy.
I know. Welcome to the Gold Coast, bad. I don't know what they do in Melbourne, but, you know. Anyway, Kanye, because you're putting a digital thing, your product, well, it turns out he's changed the product multiple times. So he's put his song out. He's so big that it's just a song. Bang, there it is, whatever it is. Let's think of a Kanye song. Right, but then he's gone, the backups are a bit too loud, reproduces it and releases it again in iTunes, right? Mm-hmm. So people have gone, oh, but I like that bit.
Yeah.
But he keeps chipping away at these songs.
I didn't know he did that.
Yeah.
I mean, you're never happy. Apparently. I listen to Ophelia because the version I sent you was the demo and even the version I have now – and it's like done, like me and Josh were like, yeah, this is it. This is the one. But at the same time, there's still so many, there's like little things I'm like, but like I've spoken to every creative and I think all of them will say like they'll never be 100% happy with it because.
They shouldn't be.
It's just, I don't know. It's just part of it, I think. And just you got to move on. And, you know, like I said, I've been writing Ophelia and working on it and performing it for like over a year now. And it's just ready. It's my little baby and I'm ready to put it out in the world.
Greasy, you'll add to this because you listen to more music than anyone I know. It's those songs that have that are a little bit dirty. I love. Like I love a good live version of something because, oh, he's got a bum note. Can you hear that G string isn't tuned up properly? Or so it takes a good artist to be able to stop.
Yeah.
Go, no, that's and let go. Some reason that's good. Let that thing out.
The worst one is when you really love a track but they can't get the sample cleared. You know, and then it like there's a band called Stereo MCs who released a great track called Lost in Music, and in the official music video for that, which is I'm going back 30 years, it was one of the first UK rap songs that was just cool as, and they did Lost in Music, and it contained some sample that was just wicked, and then they got rid of that on the album, and it's really hard to track down the cool version, which is actually in the video.
Wow.
You know, and it's really hard because you watch the video and Lost in Music video. Baseline just pumps, and then you go and buy the album, and it's like, well, what's this? This isn't. You wouldn't dance to this.
You know what I heard this week? You know, because it's a bittersweet symphony. This life.
Yeah, the Rolling Stones on that.
Yeah. Well, but old mate, what's his name? Richard,
the singer.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's Richard
Stereo. Who's that? What's that band? Anyway, he got sued because he didn't use the original version. He used someone else's version. So he actually got sued for that song, that sample of the.
No, it's just a violin.
Yeah, but it's actually a sample from someone else's version of the original.
Of a Rolling Stones song. Wow.
Yeah, so he didn't get sued it was even worse for him.
And that's going to get worse as we go forward because there's just been a law passed in Europe called Article 13, which is heavy about the a lot of people are arguing that it's a censorship law. They're bringing it in to shut down anybody who creates a meme that they don't like. This is what people are saying on the internet, arguing back and forward. But you can, let's say, make a music video, and you might put a photo in there just panning across the background that someone else has taken, and then the developing software on YouTube that will recognize that photo or that section of music or that piece of video and go, that's actually belonged to someone else. You need clearance, and they'll just pull your track down instantly.
Well, it was the Avalanches. They took years and years to get the most recent track they did because there was so much sampling in it, and they had to get it all, like, put through, and that's why it took them so long. I remember hearing that.
That's
a
great Melbourne band. You want to hear a great EP, listen to their first EP. Far out, it was cool. Hey, I got a good idea. I feel like we should perform that song now.
Sweet.
Yeah? And then we'll come on back, right? But first, let's all do this. Let's look at this camera.
Which camera?
Grab your little gas thing at the back.
Oh, here we go. This is becoming a thing.
Ready? 1, 2, 3. Doozy!
Oh, mine's not working.
Oh, you're too light.
I'm not heavy enough. I'm too small.
You need more real wood smoked saveloys.
People do lift. My sponsor. Do lift me up and throw me around.
Do they? You're a flyer. Are you a flyer?
Yeah, I'm a flyer.
Damn.
Yeah, have you not seen the photos?
I wouldn't
Instagram?
Trust anyone.
There's some like Arnold Schwarzenegger.
Yeah, I do. You do. You.
Just up in the air like that.
Yeah, I've seen that photo, but
you build relationships with your team and you learn to trust them.
Yeah, but what if you're like you're up in the air and one looks up and goes, huh? You're like, oh no.
Just perform. Just smile.
Okay. All right, let's get ready, Az. You ready, champ?
I'm stuck.
What I'm gonna do here is I'm gonna keep recording and this is what's gonna happen, right? Oh, no. I'm going to stop because I'm going to put the song in. Yeah.
Is this recording now?
Yeah.
Oh, shit.
Oh, but I can edit.
Okay, good. She fell from new heights in the heat of February. There she met a phantom. Her face stood too face, too hard to tell. He whispered in her ear, how does it feel to have no agency? You're just a petal thrown in the river. Slowly you will drift. So she sings, wondering if it's really true. They wouldn't believe even if they knew. Chilling underneath her skin, no reflection to find, but the phantom is there inside her mind. So she lured it to false ease, such a tease, hope no trace it leaves. And just like a dandelion, she blew the phantom into the wind. She sings,
wondering if it's really true. They wouldn't believe even if they knew. Rosemary for memories and panties for my thoughts. Fennel and columbines of rue. I'll wear your daisies with a different scent. Herb of grace only for Sundays that have given you violets, but they withered away where my heart was left.
And god damn, I had goosebumps just watching what see, this is a little show here. Chloe Violet, that's your real name, right?
Yeah.
And we were we're actually, before we met you, we were saying Chloe Violet is probably one of the greatest, most rock and roll names of all time. And your character is Douzey. Is character the right word?
The songs are Douzey. Yeah, it's a character, I guess. An idea.
Yeah, right. Soda. I love them both, but damn, Chloe Violet. See, that's a famous name, isn't it? So where are you from? In because Craig over here is from Shepparton.
Oh, country boy.
Yeah.
I'm from, like, northern suburbs, northeast suburbs.
Which one?
Oh, it's called Greensboro.
You are on the run.
No, it's just no one really knows. Okay. Here, no,
Greensboro.
Near
Eltham?
Yeah. Okay. Yeah, right next to Eltham. Yeah.
Right. Okay, so big engines up from Eltham.
Oh, there you go.
There you go.
Oh, wow.
Hey, Peter Lana. You could suck. Anyway.
But yeah,
that's the one thing I'm going to edit out. How about that? No, come on. Let's shake it off. See, you did. To see you singing that song and what we did around you, we got right into it, actually.
Yeah,
you know, we really did.
Fun. That was
so
fun.
I'm so stoked. I'm so proud of everyone in this room that we actually achieved that, because you've appeared out of nowhere. This is the 211th episode. So you think of it at our end, we've had loads of different people in this studio.
Oh, wow.
But it feels like, not that we've created you, you were already you, but the way we found you is just the greatest thing. So I'm stoked. I'm hope that
it was destiny.
and I hope, and I feel like we are, but you know, I always say in this show, because we don't just ring up big stars. We could, you know, there's this, you know, we could ring up anyone and just say, "Hey, come on the show." We kind of tend to just people we like.
Yeah,
and that's what makes it cool. And the spider web just gets bigger and bigger and bigger.
Yeah,
from someone says, "Oh, you should get old mate on because he just did this thing," or what about Thingo Nitro Circus or whatever, you know. So
just casually, whatever.
So I hope to think that we're going to be saying in the future, "Damn, we got Douzey on here when she was just Douzey," you know?
When, like, I was emerging.
Anyway.
It's good. No,
so
it's exciting.
So keep rocking and keep saying yes to
always.
Those
That's
shows.
One thing you got to do. It's always, like, be ready for opportunities. I think, as you were saying earlier, like, I had a bunch of songs ready to go, didn't really know what I was doing, and this opportunity came up and it was like, oh, I'm ready for this.
Yeah.
And, yeah.
Well, see, Greasy and I, we were in a band called The Bastards. It was like for a couple of years, Greasy. Oh, the picture's up there. Yeah.
It's good fun.
Right? And without, I'm not going to say any names here, we found ourselves rocking out with a couple of guys in the band that didn't really want to do any shows.
Oh.
After all these years of, like, jamming, there was like this, but... You know, you're in the position being the leader of the gang.
Yeah.
You just go, "Well, you don't want to be in it? Bang! Well, I'm going to get another drummer. I'm going to get another thing. Because this is it could line up for you." Just like Adam Brand. We're speaking to Adam Brand tonight. He actually said to me that he had a band. He was in a band. He was Adam Brand. Then he came famous, and then for a laugh, he went into a band where everyone was splitting it equal. But it came, it became the same pain in the ass that it feels for most bands. So
it's about surrounding yourself with people who are, you know, are supportive. And I'm really lucky that I've finally found a bunch of people who have been like, you know what, I'm going to help you and support you. And, you know, I was in a band, but we all came into the band. It happened organically, which the band's called Metadata. We do have stuff actually on Spotify you can check out. And I adore all the boys, but it was a circumstance of two of us were like, we want to perform, we want to get out there, we want to write more music, and the others were just chill. And it was like we just all met at this beautiful studio called Jets. Which is a little, I wouldn't be the artist I am today if it wasn't for this little studio called Jets in Bundoora, because they were just like, they always said yes. I was like, I want to sing and perform, and they're like, yeah, here you go, here's a studio, here's a mentor, and that's how my band got together. But then, a bunch of people, again, like they didn't want to perform, they didn't want to pull their weight.
Yeah, right.
So I was like, this is what I want to do, this is... Metadata.
I was in a band called Control Alt Delete.
Oh, that's a great name.
Isn't it?
That's such a good name.
It's kind of layered, like, ooh, that means so much.
Yeah. There's a band called Alt J, and it's the key for on Max to make a triangle. And I thought that's very, like.
Really?
Yeah, it's very, very
I
meta.
Didn't even know that. I've got a Mac.
Alt-J. Well, I didn't know that either, but then I found it out. And Alt J, a brilliant band.
Alt J, so. My new favorite band. Mm. This whole podcast is dedicated to Alt J.
Oh.
Yeah?
Why
I mean, they're...
Greasy, give us some questions. What do you got?
What's the plan after the album? Are you just going to get this done, go to Europe?
I've already got another EP. Like, I have so many songs. I want to finish this EP and I want to just perform. I want to hopefully do some gigs in Melbourne, do some gigs up here, maybe do some... I would love to do all of Australia and all of the world, essentially. I already have... another EP written and good to go, but I need to focus because I'm terrible at focusing. But just writing and hopefully towards the end of the next year, maybe a full album.
And
I don't know.
What kind of styles do you branch out? Like, is it all? You mentioned earlier.
Is it all Hamlet rock?
It's Shakespeare rock. I have another. So this EP, a lot of the songs I chose on it because. They are inspired by literature because I studied a lot of literature and I studied, there's a song on it called Medea and it's based off a Euripides play, which is a Greek tragedy. And so that song's on the EP. There was another song on it that was a Shakespeare song and it was based on Macbeth, but I had to cut that one eventually just because time... I hopefully will get to record it in the future. And then the next EP I think is going to be more piano-based, whereas this one's more guitar and acoustic. And I definitely pull from, like, electronic elements. Like, Grimes is, like, a really big inspiration for me and she just does everything herself and produces everything herself. And also Clipping, their music production. They're, like, a hip-hop band from Chicago and they're so... intricate with all their recordings and I'd love to move into more R&B stuff as well as more electronic stuff.
What do you think of Sia?
I love Sia. She's obviously one of my biggest inspirations, like an Adelaide girl. So
yeah, I was thinking today, right? Imagine being someone like Sia or even Rihanna. Like when I was going back to, we only see the pop star at the end of the day, but if you think of, and everyone takes the piss out of these people.
Yeah.
But if you actually have made it to the top, think of Rihanna, right? Or Sia. We know Sia, she's a songwriter with this killer voice. So she's actually been invited, I'd imagine. You know, she's undeniably unreal and got to this certain point.
Absolutely.
But imagine being, say, someone like Rihanna when there's a million talented, or Beyonce or whatever, right? They've fought. You can take the piss out of the big stars all you want, but... particularly someone, and I don't know anything about Rihanna, I'm just using her as a point. Like, why has she got to the point in her career right now?
Yeah.
She must be special. She must be talented. She must say the right things in all things off stage.
Absolutely.
You know?
There is that artistic side and then there is that element of, marketing, which is annoying because sometimes as an artist you're a bit self-deprecating. But yeah, Sia was writing for big names for ages, and then I think David Guetta picked up her vocals and chucked it on a track, and she was like famous and huge, and I think that's really good. I was a massive fan of her beforehand. Me and my mum had this CD, I can't think of the name of it, it's the pink one, and there's this one song in it, and when I was in high school or like primary school, she would drive me to and from gymnastics and cheerleading, and we would always play this one album by Sia. And when I was recording these songs, I linked a couple of, like, these are my inspirations, like, give them a listen because this is the vibe I want. And Sia's album was one of them. So hopefully it comes across.
That's great.
Nice.
Her voice. Yeah, I don't know what song. You know, I was in a factory, someone else's factory all day today, listening to CFM on the Gold Coast. So I think everyone in every city in Australia has a CFM, you know, and we have a Gold Coast one, which pretty much means they just play top 40. So it's one of those.
Okay.
Oh, CFM. You know, one of those cheese ball, and I can't stand listening to it, only because you're hearing some of the worst music coming out that people love, and I don't judge anyone for it, but there's always a Sia song in the middle of the day. I go, man, that's a singer.
Mm.
She can just wail.
Well, I bought tickets for my mom for her birthday when she came to Australia last year, and throughout I was like, this doesn't sound like she's performing. It just sounds like she's miming.
Wow.
But then she changed up what song was it? She says Titanium instead of saying Titanium in the last bit. She's like, I'm Australian. I was like, okay. She is singing live. Like, because there was a part of me that was like, oh, my goodness. And we were quite far back because it was huge.
Right. It sounded so stadium. Good.
It sounded so on point that.
Yeah. We were talking about that. Speaking of Matt Tenpin Bowland, when we had the guys that were doing a tribute to these 90s bands, right?
Nice.
They played right here. They set up the full band, didn't they, guys?
God. How did they fit?
I don't know. We just got them in, right? But they sounded exactly like the record. That's the thing. And I was like, yo, thank you for doing that. Thank you for not doing even this much vocal of your own style. Mm. So that's when you really appreciate your song. And I love that. What about you go see your favourite band, and for some reason the singer wants to sing the chorus differently. Like, no!
Oh, you see, a legend, like I saw Ozzy Osbourne, I mentioned it last week, went to see this rock festival, Ozzy Osbourne, and it was just the biggest letdown you've ever seen in a festival or a concert ever. He's got to retire, but he was just basically, every time there was a high note, he'd just hold the mic out and then he'd say,
crowd.
Yeah, he'd be like, generals gathered in there. And the whole crowd would go, masses. And he'd be like, yeah. And then he'd go, just like, hold it out again. And it's like, hold on, Ozzy, we're doing the whole bloody song here, mate.
Wow.
You know?
Yeah, I can't stand that.
Good, you know? The other thing I was going to mention earlier about people get picked up by producers, just like people who strumming guitars in their bedroom and then become superstars. A friend of mine in Ireland, she, a beautiful voice, kind of folky singer, playing in cafes, and somebody sent her this basic beat, and she made these beautiful lyrics over it, and voice is magic, just recorded into her phone in her car. And then this DJ called Tiesto heard it, and he's a huge DJ in Europe, and he remixed it into this song called Moonlight Party or something like that. It became the number one downloaded song of the decade as a ringtone.
Wow.
But because there was so many people between her and the actual final people who put the final thing out, she got bugger all money out of it.
Okay.
You know, and they put somebody else in the video, and they tried to re-record the lyrics with loads of other people, and they just couldn't match her voice because she's got such an incredible, unique voice.
Yeah.
So she had a big struggle with that. So,
so don't put your songs on any ringtones.
Okay. Well,
isn't it interesting how certain voices, like I hear Sia, when you listen to those cheeseball radio stations, you're like, man, that could be anyone. That could be anyone. Mm. Then all of a sudden you go, well, that's pretty really great for some reason.
Yeah.
Sia, Rihanna, I don't know. And they cut through to everyone's ears, you know, like your friend Greasy.
If you can stand to listen to those kind of stations, and you know, I like to listen to good music all the time, but sometimes you listen to stations and there's 8 or 9 crap songs, and then one comes on and you go, wow.
Yeah.
That was worth waiting for, you know.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's a, an amazing artist. Her name's Napalm from Melbourne. She's the lead singer of Hiatus Katie. I'm a massive fan. And her voice, she's so low and she can get so high and she's so brilliant. And she had a similar thing where I think Drake sampled her. And then and then she ended up writing a song with Anderson .Paak and so all these big name artists, and she's just incredible.
They played Blues Fest last year, I think.
Hiatus Katie.
Yeah.
Oh yeah, they're amazing. They're doing a gig in Melbourne at the moment, and I'm like, I'm not there.
Yeah, that's so wild. Can I tell you something? When I first recorded at Red's, no, it wasn't my first one, but Red's Ed Studio, we went in there, four guys, guitars and drums, and it was 1990. The technology only then, right, which is probably a million years ago to you. Yeah, were you born? You weren't even dead. You weren't even born. I had a beard.
I wasn't even thought of. I think my sister was just
born. Oh, they were thinking about
dad
you.
Dad didn't even have a beard.
They were thinking about you every night. No, no shit.
Her dad didn't
welcome
even
to
have
my
a beard.
Show. Now, listen. We would play our track just like you did just now, and I'm the rhythm guitarist. The drummer had just done his bit, and we're like, shit, don't mess it up, man. We've only got 3 hours because there's no digital messing around. I did my guitar bit with the, you know, the guitars in my ears, or played it live.
Yeah.
But if you messed it up, they had to actually go to the tape, right, cut the tape with scissors, get some sticky tape, and join some bits together.
Wow.
Yeah. And that wasn't even that long ago. To think now that Drake can find Napalm without even meeting her.
Yeah, and that's the brilliant thing with the internet. I know people complain about it, but I think it's a beautiful thing when you get to reach out.
Yeah, but what a step in no time. Yeah. I'm talking, that's magic. Through the air.
You know my mate.
Actually, through the sky, someone has come from the other side of the world and just gone, brip, brip, yeah. Brip, hit.
Yeah.
You know my mate.
Where's
Lamar?
The damn money then come from?
True. You know my mate Lamar, the producer. So I got this top producer as a friend of mine in Sydney. There's loads of famous people where you can just download just the vocals from famous songs, and he's always remixing them and doing just for fun, just putting them on some random Spotify account, no name Spotify account,
like a David.
So he sent me one yesterday, and it was called "Smells Like Black Sabbath," and it was "Smells Like Teen Spirit." Mixed over a track that sounded like Black Sabbath, and he put it together, and it's a really slow, cool track, and it's
that's
called.
Amazing.
And then he did another one with Freddie Mercury, and he put this cool dance beat behind another one, Bites the Dust,
like a mashup sort of.
Yeah, it's like a mashup, and it just. But there's none of the original song, just the vocals, and a totally different vibe, and it sounds cool. You know, because he's a good producer.
Right, and he can put it out anonymously and someone might go, yeah, that's the new...
I think he just does it for fun.
Yeah. Oh, my God, can I tell you something just crazy? So I was at this same shop yesterday and they decided to turn off CFM and they had, somehow, they had the record, you know that song, Blow Your Whistle. Blow Your Whistle. That fucking horrible song. You know, the worst...
That's like
dance song.
What noise
I don't know it, but I can.
Make?
I understand the vibe.
That's all.
Exactly.
Well, that's it. Well, it turns out this guy has a whole CD, right? And the other songs were
all of it.
Protect your ears. Protect your ears. I had to listen
to
a whole
sampled.
Record.
Far
it's pretty easy. So he, what I'm getting at is his "Blow Your Whistle" song took off. It was the same sort of deal. He's just some person that created. Music.
Yeah, absolutely.
Where do we find you, Douzey?
So on the socials, so I'm on Instagram. My tag is at DouzeyMuse, spelt DouzeyMuse, and then I'm on Facebook as well. And then hopefully I am officially releasing Ophelia in the next 2 weeks, so you'll find it on iTunes and Spotify and Unearthed and all that jazz, so you'll be able to listen to it whenever.
What about your cover art?
So literally when I was getting here, my friend, his name is Guy Ritani, is doing the cover art as we speak. He's texting me all these things on the way, and I was like, I've got to turn my phone off, but... You know, keep sending me all the stuff. So hopefully that's the only thing we're waiting on right now is actually the cover art. So I'm super excited. It looks – it's amazing. I had an idea and I sent him my idea and he like went with it and he's made it even more amazing than I thought it ever would be. So I'm really excited for that.
Yeah, cool. Well, Rika, who isn't here, right? I wish she was, but she's not. But she raised a good thing in this competition that we just did. She said, and you know, everyone in this room thought the same thing. I thought it was just a song competition. You had your song, which it kind of was at first. But then I realised I got such a when I saw what you look like, or just the way you styled yourself on social media, it filled in this huge picture, right?
Yeah.
So then I looked up every band that was in this competition and I went, well, why don't I like that picture of this other band? You know what I mean? It actually filled, you know, everyone needs visuals. Everyone needs an album cover. You know, like Greasy's got a million records, I'm sure, at his house, where you'd hold the record and go, yeah, this is everything I want it to be in this particular artist.
And the art is that, because I was looking at patterns and just maybe having a thing, but my whole, like I was saying, my whole EP, except for one song, is all inspired by literature, and I love surrealist film and theatre, and so I really wanted to draw from those things that I really, really love. So I've kind of put it all together in this. The picture reflects what the songs, and it, like you said when you were talking about it on the first week, you hit it on the nail on the head. It's supposed to be this eerie kind of, you know, femme fatale kind of idea with Ophelia, because originally she is perceived as this dreary thing, but she does have agency and she does have she knows what she wants. So I wanted.
Can you play piano?
Yes, I actually was trained on piano when I was in primary school. I did a lot of piano, but then I got a bit too cool for it in high school and stopped for a bit, and so now I'm back into it. And I do a lot of my writing on piano at home.
What about the most? What's the first song you remember?
I remember learning.
And I'll ask you, Greasy. And I'll ask everyone in this room. The first song they actually remember and thought was cool.
As in, remember playing? Like, I remember learning.
Well, it
Mary
came
Had
on the record,
Lane.
And the, you were like, yeah, I love music. I love this song for some reason. Maybe I like music, you know.
I think Paramore was like a big influence, so Hayley Williams' voice. So I'm going to have to say them. I remember the first album I remember being obsessed with was their Brand New Eyes, which had it's a big song now, and I cover it all the time. When I was younger, I saw You Are the Only Exception. Like, you are the only exception, and you are. So it has that song on it, Brick by Burning Brick, but that whole album, and I've seen them. The most. I've seen them about four times, like every time they come to Melbourne.
Well, that's actually Aaron's favourite record.
Brand New Eyes by Paramore. You're kidding.
Yeah. Everyone in Townsville plays that, right, Aaron? Yeah?
All the time.
Okay, Aaron, if you say Adam Brand, I know we love him, right? What was the first song that you remember? I'm actually, I know mine, but you guys won't know it.
Well, what's yours?
All right. See, you guys won't be old enough, but I put on my blue jeans, on my old blue jeans. Who is that? I put my old blue jeans.
Aaron,
you just went up a peg. You're already at the top. Now you're standing on top of this ladder.
It's got that weird jangly guitar in
I've
that
got
song.
My old blue jeans on. So, Matt G, what's the first song you remember?
Ever.
It was just one. What comes to mind? All the way from London.
The very first album ever had was Flash Gordon by Queen.
Oh, shit. Flash Gordon by Queen.
Yeah. Actually, I would say Queen. My dad was a massive Queen fan. I would have to say,
Flash Gordon approaching.
Actually, for my gig tomorrow, I am covering Queen. So,
oh, yeah, which song?
Somebody to Love. I love that song.
Love me. Craig, always from Shepparton.
My first album was Susie Quatro's Greatest
Hits. Susie Quatro's Greatest Hits. Yeah, that's cool.
Nice. My first album I bought was Lily Allen.
Lily Allen. Yeah.
So I'm really proud of that. So some people have some pretty daggy ones, but Lily Allen, Smile.
Yeah.
Like, I cover that song now also.
She's cool.
She's
flat out cool. She, and I'll get to you in a minute, Greasy, but She's like, Lily Allen is the, you know, if I was to be a, someone like you, I'd be like the Streets, you know, the Streets. Yeah, Mike Skinner.
That's
anyway.
Old guy music.
Too. Well, it is, but damn.
Well, now I can look him up.
Well, you're fit, but you know it. Oh, man.
Maybe you should get up and sing some.
That's it. We only get old people in this studio.
Different generation.
You're listening to community radio on the...
Yeah, I know. Man, I can't believe it. No, well, no, Lily Allen, she's kind of like a street-y person.
Yeah, who can, she's so cool.
What's that song about? She's talking about, you know, blowjobs and that.
Oh, it's, you know, not, I mean? Fair. Same, that I remember, same situation, driving home from training.
Crikey.
When I was listening to the Sia album, yeah. And It's Not Fair came on, and my mum laughed, and it was the most awkward. Like, I was like 14, and obviously, like, I knew, and she knew, and she started laughing, and it was just like the most awkward car ride ever. Because I, it was funny.
But she's like, you know, I'm not getting creepy on you, but she's actually, who else could do that?
Yeah.
Only Lily Allen and maybe
and
a
Kate
few
Nash.
Others.
Yeah, yeah, Kate Nash is just like. Right, so that, in there.
That's someone who can ride the. I don't know what she's doing now, but
she's still she's gearing up to release her newest album. Actually,
she got a little political. I hate when and they do that. Mm. I really do. What about you, Greasy? First record, and don't be cool.
I don't
be as daggy as you
no,
can.
No,
be.
No, no. In truth, the first time I ever went into a record shop and bought a vinyl record, it was the single by a band called Musical Youth. And pass the Duce, you know that.
Pass the Duce on the left hand side. Say, give me as a border, as a listen to the beat. Give me a memory. It's like, I had that single too.
That was the first record I ever bought.
That was actually like a, they were younger than teenagers. They were like 10, 12 year old.
Oh, yeah.
And they're singing about passing a joint or passing the dope bowl.
No,
actually was. Pass the Duce on the left hand side.
I think it was about. A food bowl. When we were kids, we were told it was a food bowl. But relating to that, the first song I ever thought was cool was Golden Brown by the Stranglers.
Oh, yeah.
I remember hearing that when I was
a kid.
Well,
that's about heroin.
Exactly.
Geez, good on you.
All these druggy songs.
Yeah.
But, that was a great song. And I remember saying it to my dad, like, what, you know, just, what is this? And he was like, that's about drugs. I'm like, mate, I'm about six. I don't even know what drugs are. Just, it's a good song.
You know. But I think I'll like them in the future. I don't know.
What
do you think about drugs? No, don't listen to me. It's getting late. Doozy, I really want to hear that Homer song. Can I? Is it released? It's not released.
No, it's not finished yet.
Can I put it at the end of this podcast?
It might not be finished for a little while. Oh. But when it's finished,
can I
definitely
make a song called Homer?
It is. It's literally
using Greasy's cough that he's been trying to suppress all night.
It's honestly a song about hummus. Like,
is it?
It's about my friend's mom made like this brilliant hummus, and I actually wrote it as a joke song for my friend. And then she was like, "This is really good." And then I had a gig, so I was like, "I'll play it," and everyone loved it. And it's a bit funny. It's a silly fun song.
Give us a bit of chorus.
My friend, she puts the hummus on the table. I promise I'll be there soon. She cares for her brothers and her sisters, 'cause that's how she and what she da 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 da.
Nice.
It's a really fun song. It's because of the dudes, everyone comes in for it, and yeah, it's just a silly, fun song. I'm really excited for that song to come out. There's like, I was like, I want maracas. I want a tambourine.
Yeah. I love songs. I love the band UMI, right? Another band. You wouldn't even know. Jeez, it burns me
up inside. Purple Sneakers.
Yeah, but they would, Purple Sneakers, they were singing about drinking red wine under a bridge in Glebe. Like things that you can go, oh, yeah, I live next to Glebe.
Yeah.
Things you really relate to.
Absolutely.
So when someone starts writing songs about stuff that just need a little, just like this podcast, I really like to talk about
every day
the stuff. And so anyone listening goes, oh, yeah, I've been there.
Yeah.
I know that story. Yeah, wow. So,
and you can visualize it.
Come on, champ. Yeah. Come on.
I like when I write notes because I'm always writing. I'm always thinking of things, so I always write it down. And I was going back through stuff, and I was like, oh, that was when I remember where I was when I wrote things, when I read them. I was like, ah. Oh. And, like, often, like, I remember I wrote this whole little piece on, like, being inside the London train and what it smelt like and all this stuff. And I went back. I was like, that's when I was living in London.
You went to London?
Yeah, I lived in London for a little while.
Whereabouts?
So I resided in the southwest in Shepherd's Bush.
Okay, cool. Yeah.
Yeah, and that was really intense. I was 19 and just was like, Mom, I'm not catching my flight home, and lived there for a little while.
What about, okay. Do you know who also did that?
Who?
Iggy Azalea.
Oh, really?
She's from just around here.
Yeah. Oh, really?
She went to Florida and told her mum that she was just going on a two-week holiday with her girlfriend, and then at 2 weeks said, I'm not coming back.
Yeah.
You know, and well, she's someone else who has fought. She's just honestly from where's Ellen Briggs from? She was here two podcasts ago.
Woolloombah?
No, the other one.
Mullumbimby.
Yeah. So Iggy Azalea is from 40 minutes away.
Yeah. Well, I was actually intending on coming home, but then I was like, I'm going to stay. And then I was in the share house, and it was so much fun. I made lots of friends, and there was a broken guitar in the basement, and I just glued it back together, restrung it, got YouTube out. And that's when I kind of started writing music,
right?
With the idea of, like, I want to write music and all that stuff. So here I am a few years later.
Here's a nerd question. Do you just record on your phone, or, you know, if you have an idea?
Yeah, I record on my phone all the time if I have ideas, and then GarageBand, and then I go into the studio, what I was talking about, Jet Studio. I would go in there and put it all together.
Have you looked at studios in Brisbane? Now, have you done that
I've
yet?
Looked at them, but I think I will record back in Melbourne with my same, just because I have this brilliant team that I've slowly got together, and I would like to work with them from now on. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. No, I love that nerd. Let's get into it. What else is there?
It's hard.
So you said you've got a Shure SM58 already. You have
I've got my own gear.
That's the mic.
You know what I got recently?
I don't record on this, no.
No, I mean, but it's the working band mic, you know. It's the thing, and it took me 20 years to own one.
Yeah. I got
like $280 bucks.
I got sick of terrible, because we were a loud band, so I got sick of terrible sound at gigs from people with their phones or high-end cameras that just couldn't record the audio. So I paid about $500 bucks and bought this thing by Zoom, who make guitar pedals and musical instruments. They make cameras as well now.
Mm.
So I've got this thing called a Zoom Q2N, I think it's called, but it's basically a tiny little, it's like a GoPro, but it's got a massive mic, 360 degree mic just right on top of it. Half the camera's a mic, and you can set the dB level. So if you're at a gig and you just see that half the back of the camera is just these little meter reader for the sound, and you just stop it from going yellow, and then basically you just do whatever you want, and you can be at the loudest rock concert ever, and it's you know,
that's unreal.
I brought it to a gig that was in a tin warehouse, and then it was a massive. It wasn't far from here. It was just a big shed, and there was about 100 people there. And put that camera there, and everyone was like, "Who recorded that sound?" I was like, just somebody sitting at a table holding the camera.
Yeah,
and they were like, "Wow, it sounds great."
Because didn't we all find out the hard way with a GoPro? Yeah, I've got the GoPro with the waterproof case, and then you hold it up, and it. Because it's in a waterproof case. Like, shit, I've got to take it out. And even then, the sound is really bad. It's not a microphone camera.
I did that at a Brant Bjork gig. He's an ex-Caius. So he's a really loud, bassy, you know, double E strings or whatever on his guitar. It's just loud, bassy guitar. Bought him a GoPro. Fantastic gig. And then you're watching this.
Yeah, and the wind. Yeah, absolutely. I mean, I have a couple of gigs that I've done live acoustic on YouTube, and the sound's there. It's not ideal, but
we'll get there.
You know what?
You just got to slowly build like your gear, and I think that was the biggest thing. When you want to be seen more professional, you need to have your own gear and be able to transport. But I had to leave my PA in Melbourne because it's huge. But
you got your own PA too?
Yeah, in Melbourne, and I ran.
God damn, Douzey. This is what I'm talking about, Steve.
It's good for parties. It's real good. It's real good for parties.
Hell yeah.
Yeah, that's pretty weird, you know.
What, having your own PA?
Yeah, you've got your own mic, your own PA.
Because I would run my own
Buses by the Creek, right? That's something that we're heavily involved in.
Yeah.
think of this, 153 acts go there over 2 days, and pretty much 90% of people go there and go, oh, you know, no one owns, no one has their stuff. Like, it's really rare. It's, and I'm talking about people right up to 40. Like,
I think.
Come on, champ. Come on.
Yeah. And it's good.
Have you got any choreography you put into your show?
I would love to. Like, in my head, there's, it's a big, I would love to
you
put on a big
kick-ass
show.
You could do a kick-ass video. Hey,
yeah, I've already got ideas for my cheer friends to be.
All right, guys, Craig, I think the Ophelia song, right? I can just see the start.
You're not having it at a song.
Out of focus, right? I'm going to say my bit. I'm going to say my bit. But I can see at the end, you turn it into some sort of, like, cheer thing. Dun, dun, dun. I can actually see it, but it's got to start off out of focus. Like, whoever's playing the guitar, me, probably, whatever. Like, dun, dun,
do you want to just do it? You should do a cover of it. You should just do a cover of the song, I reckon.
Who plays guitar on that?
So me and Alexi.
Who plays
guitarist.
The very last notes?
That's me.
That's cool as hell. Because what you do there, you're actually messing around like you're Malcolm Young from AC/DC. Because you're going, you know, the pattern, but you start messing around right in the last one.
The plucking is Alexid.
Yeah. Who's Alexid?
Alexi is the guitarist.
Is that
the guitarist?
Girl or boy?
Boy.
Alexi, I love you. How about that? How about that? No, really, that struck me as something cool. Because just like all these bands from this list, once you finally get in a band, you go, okay, my job is to just play this sort of stuff. We get that stuff done. But it's rare you'll find someone like, you know, in Greasy's band, there's a dude called Rowie Riot.
Mm.
Right? He explores the guitar, you know, like you actually have to have some personal confidence.
Yeah, absolutely. So. 100% agree with that.
And even though AC/DC was, people would think they're straight ahead rock and roll, the reason everyone loves the rhythm guitar player Malcolm is because he's constantly playing the same stuff but sort of getting loose with it and changing some certain chord shapes. And everyone's tried to do it since. Anyway, I'm boring the hell out of you.
Yeah.
But I'm entertaining me and that's all that matters.
Right.
Well, hey, you've got some gigs coming up.
Yes, so tomorrow, or depending on when this is posted, but on Thursday I am playing at the Milk Factory at 8 o'clock. I'm supporting live and local musicians Fee and Salmon and the Peaches. And then on Saturday I've been invited to Long Palm? Is it? Lost Palms on Saturday. They've invited
Miami,
Miami, which will be more of an acoustic setup.
That was my other question. Yeah. Yeah, so you've got a full sort of acoustic setup.
Yeah, so I've got a full acoustic setup. I do busking and perform like cafe gigs and such, but then I also have like my performance gig. So tomorrow is going to be a really big performance with all my own original songs and one cover. And then I think Saturday will be a bit of both.
Do you not have a car?
No, I've just moved here.
Do you have your driver's license?
I do, but I've just moved here.
Are you a bad driver? Are you?
I am a terrible driver. Yeah. The day I moved out, I crashed both my parents' cars into each other. So this price...
Rock and roll!
Yeah.
Take that, mum, take that, dad, into the pool.
It was totally by accident. This prize money is just going to that, to be honest.
Damn it.
My mum was not happy. Nor my dad.
All right,
sorry.
Greasy.
that's too funny, man.
Look, I just think you can't be good at everything, and driving is not one of them.
No, well, hey, can I tell you, my grandmother, rest in peace, she lived her entire life without having a driver's license. Like, so people drove her around, and I've got a friend who's the same. Like, they just live this, like, stress in their life is, like, getting, who's going to pick me up today? Yeah, and they show up like they're the Pope. You're like, woohoo.
Maybe I should study.
But we're, like, driving around going, no, motherfucker.
Yeah.
Like, oh, I got to pay that rego, you know.
Yeah, I would like to get a car, but it's just not.
So how'd you get down here tonight? On the train?
Yeah, the train.
Oh, wow.
Yeah. Okay. And then Aaron.
Yeah, as a brother.
Me up.
Super
man.
Producer.
Woo.
All right, hey, wait, you got to get back on a train then.
Yeah.
All right,
while
hey.
While it's still running.
Well, thank you for coming in. Put it there, champ.
Thanks.
You did good
thank
out there.
Thank you for having me.
You're number one. Never
good
forget
to
that.
Good to meet you. We'll be talking
well,
soon.
When I release Hummus, I should come back and
yeah,
we can
please.
Do that.
That's the thing. Come back 4, 5, 6 times.
Oh, that sounds fabulous.
That's the nature of this show. So, Craig, anything you want to say? All good? Aaron?
I'm good too. Have a good night. See you next time.
Good work.
Sounds great. Woo!
Greasy, I'm going to let you finish this one.
No, I just want to say thanks for coming in, Douzey, and look forward to helping you with put this video together and hearing all of the music to come and probably seeing you Saturday.
Yeah, awesome. Please
excellent.
Come.
Excellent, yeah. This podcast is brought to you by Koala Karma, the chill out drink. Sit back, relax, and I just got that last burping.
Sayonara, Natsuka. Oh.